So we've been discussing two different types of manifold learning methods. The first one was local linear embedding, and the second one was Laplacian eigenmaps. And what I've been trying to do is to demonstrate that even though they operate on slightly different principles, the computational techniques end up being fairly similar. So in the case of LLE, what one does is that one reconstructs the every data point as a linear combination of its k near names. So this, maybe I should add here, the summation is I needs to be a neighbor of j. Okay. Okay, so we reconstruct here xj as a linear combination of the k nearest neighbors of xj. And that gives us a matrix of coefficients cij. And that matrix of coefficients can be computed in closed form. Okay. The other constraint we add, maybe I've got here, is the coefficients need to add up to 1. So 1 transpose c is equal to 1. Once we have the matrix of coefficients, then we find the low-dimensional representation, y, that minimizes the same reconstruction error. And we demonstrated that this reconstruction error can be expressed in matrix form as some trace minimization problem. And then we add the constraint that the low-dimensional representation needs to be centered and that the covariance, the y-y transpose, the identity, this last constraint is added to prevent the zero solution. On the other hand, we have Laplacian eigenmaps, where we use the data just for the finite set of weights. Typically, we can use, for example, here the a Gaussian set of weights. And the idea here is that that weight is going to be large if the two points xi and xj are closed. So this is sort of a cost where you pay that if xi and xj are close to each other, you pay a cost on the distance between yi and yj. So the idea is that if xi and xj are close, then you would like yi and yj to be close. If xi and yj and xj are far apart, this weight is nearly zero, so you don't care. Okay? So the idea of preserving local geometry here is that if the original points are closed, the low-dimensional representation needs to be closed, and other than that, I don't care. Here, the sharp difference is that what one is trying to preserve is the coefficients of the representation. Now, the bottom problem can also be converted into a trace minimization problem. And as you can see, and the only difference is what L matrix one puts in the middle. So in this particular case, the L is equal to the D minus W. And we denoted that as the Laplacian matrix. While in this particular case, the matrix depends on the coefficients. But even though the formulations are, in principle, completely different, they both end up being trace minimization problems with different Laplacians. And I'm saying quote-unquote Laplacian because this is a proper Laplacian. This is not exactly a proper Laplacian. And I'll explain in a minute why that's the case. Now, as a matter of reminder, and this would be important for today's lecture, I want to reanalyze this. We did this already, but I want to do it in a simpler setting today, which is the setting where this was just a scalar. So suppose that I just had a problem where I have some wij, and let me do it with just a scalar. So I'm going to do, let me use a different letter. Suppose that I have that. I'm going to do the calculation very fast because I did it last time already, but obviously you can write this as wij zi squared minus 2 zi cj plus cj squared and this is 2 times the sum of D by sum over J minus EI by CI squared times 2 times sum WIJ ZI CJ. Right. Remember that DII, which is this matrix here, DII sum all the ways. So all I've done here is that this is a sum over both I and J. If you only sum over J, then you get DII, and then you still have a sum over I only of the maps. And it's 2 times because the third one is the same one. We did this calculation a couple of weeks. So then I have said this is a quadratic, and as any quadratic I can write it as Z transpose W Z, where z is the vector z1, zn. This first one is, obviously there is 2 times there, but this first one is also z transpose dz. Right? So what I'm doing is to say d11, dn, z1, zn, and here's z1, zn. That's what the first term is, okay? And this is all right? If you do the multiplication of these three, you get that. Or you get that. And for the second term, it's just the same as with W. So, this is 2 times z transpose L z. Okay. So, properties of this Laplacian matrix. First, the matrix L is positive semi-definite. Second, L times 1 is 0. Third, the dimension of the kernel of L is equal to the number of connected components. So let me prove these three properties of the graph Laplace. So what does it mean for L to be positive semi-definite? Right, so for property number one, I need to prove that for all z different from 0, well, it's actually positive semi-definite. So I just need to show, in fact, that for all z, z transpose L, z is bigger than or equal to 0. That's what I need to show. So the proof is as follows. Z transpose LZ is equal to 1/2 of the sum of the WIJs, ZI minus ZJ squared, right? That's what I just showed at the very top. Now, this quantity is bigger than or equal to 0 because it's the square of something. This quantity is bigger than or equal to 0 because I assume that the weights are non-negative. In particular, those weights that I've selected there are non-zero. So this quantity is bigger than negative. So that proves the first property, that the Laplacian is positive semi-definite. The vector of all ones is in the kernel of this matrix. L times 1 is equal to B minus W. I think I actually did this property in the last class. So this is D times 1 minus W. D times 1. The D is that matrix that I've drawn that is right there. Okay? That diagonal matrix with the DIs in the diagonal. So if I multiply by the vector of all ones, I'm gonna get just D11 Dnn. W times 1 is going to have the sum of the W1j's, the sum of the WnJ's. In other words, this is simply Dii minus the sum of the WiJ's. Right? But the sum of the Wij's is exactly the definition of the Di. So this is equal to 0. Third property. Third property, let me begin first with a picture of what I'm trying to understand here. The L matrix, this Laplacian, is an n by n matrix. So it's really the same idea as I've got n points, and what I've done is that I've connected pairs of points with a weight. So this is point 1 and point 2, this is W1, 2, this is W. 3, let's say, and now each point is connected just with a few, right? 3, 4, all right. W, 3, 5, and so on and so on. Let me just continue. Actually, maybe let me do it like this, like that. Let's say that this is 6 and 7, and this is W, 6, 7. So effectively what I've done is to take the data and create a graph where the nodes of the graphs are going to be the data points, and the edges connecting two different nodes are going to be associated a weight, and that weight is exactly the Wij. When doing so, because many weights are going to be, could potentially be zero, I don't know a priori, and in fact, as I said sometimes, for example, if you look at LLE, by construction, the weights will come from the CIJs. Those weights are zero if I and J are not nearest neighbors from each other. For this, in fact, maybe I should have said so, but I could have said this is if I is a neighbor of J. Maybe I could have said zero rather. So the idea is that some, for example, in this particular case, 5 and 7 are not connected, and they're not connected because they're not nearest neighbors from each other, let's say. And so the weight W5, 7 is 0. So what this theorem here is trying to say is that if I look at this set of connections, if I look at the corresponding graph, and I look at the number of connected components, in this particular case is 2. Then the number of eigenvalues of L that are equal to 0 is exactly equal to the number of connected components. Right? So let's try to do the proof of that. So let's suppose that I begin with the sum of wij zi minus zj squared. And let me be a little bit explicit. This is sum over j, and here I need to be a neighbor of j.
Okay,
that's
the energy function.
If the graph has two connected components, right, I can split this sum, like this sum goes from j equals 1 to n, right, so it's summing over all the nodes. I can split this sum over j by summing first over all the nodes in connected component 1, then all of the nodes in connected component 2, and so on and so forth, right? So let me assume that the number of connected components is little n. So I can split this now then into the sum j belonging to the first connected component, and now sum I belonging to n j of w I j z1 minus z j squared plus sum j belonging to the nth connected component, sum I belonging to n j w I j z I minus z j squared. Okay? Is that clear? I can just split the sum into n parts corresponding to each one of the groups. Why can I do that? The reason I can do that is because, as in this situation, right, if there are two connected components, what that means is that there is no edge connecting this one with that one. Right? And so I can really just separate based on the first sum. And it's going to do this plus that, and that's what this part entails. Plus the second part, completely separate. So look at what happens now. In fact, maybe I should have done the proof of... Aha, okay. Let me go one step back. Let me redo the proof of two in a slightly different way, which is, I wanted to prove that the vector 1 is in the null space of L. Well, if you look at this expression for L, right, if Z is the vector of all 1s, what's going on? Then Zi is equal to Zj all the time, right? So what that means is that this expression is equal to 0 in that particular case. Because if all of these Zi's are equal to the Zj's, then you get 0 squared. So what's going to happen here now is that if I can do the following trick, I can select a vector, let me call this vector 1 in connected component 1, if you wish, that has the following property. Is the vector of all 1s in the first connected component, let's say that there are n sub 1 data points in the first connected component, all others are zeros. Let me choose that. That's one. Now, the vector corresponding to the second, I'm going to define it as follows. vector corresponding to the nth connector component, and it's 0 everywhere, and 1 and 0. So I hope, look at what I can do now. If I let z be exactly this vector, what happens? Then the first term is 0 because I'm going to get 1 minus 1, correct? But then all other terms are also equal to 0 because all the z's are 0 in any case. So what I've been able to do is to generate n different vectors that make this quantity or this energy equal to 0. So what I'm going to prove now is that L times each one of these vectors is equal to 0. W matrix So let's try to do it. The matrix of weights, think about it right now. Let's go back to this picture. Suppose that I sort the data points to all of those that are in connected component number 1, then connected component number 2, then connected component number n. Look at all the weights there are. You are going to have a collection of weights for all of the nodes that correspond to the connected component number 1. But there is no weight connecting this connected component to this connected component. So as a consequence, this needs to be 0. And all others need to be 0. So what happens is that you can take the matrix of weights, and the matrix of weights actually needs to be a block diagonal matrix with weights corresponding to each one of the subgraphs of each one of the connected components. Because the degree matrix D is diagonal, if I compute now the Laplacian, which is D minus W, all that's going to happen is that I'm going to have now one Laplacian for the first group, one Laplacian for the second group, and one Laplacian for the nth group. If I go ahead and multiply that Laplacian with the vector 1, c1, okay, then I'm going to get the following, l1 times the vector 1 in dimension 1, but then all others are 0, right? Because the vector, this is a vector 1, so this is a bunch of zeros. So if I go ahead and multiply this block diagonal matrix by 1s and then a bunch of zeros, right, I'm going to get that times that, and everything else is 0. But now I've got the Laplacian of only the first connected component times the vector 1s only for that component. This needs to be 0 by the first property that we have here. Because all what we have done, I mean, this property is true for any Laplacian, right? So if I now take, if I now divide the graph into two separate connected components, then it also needs to be true that for that sub Laplacian, L times 1 is equal to 0. So this gives the 0 vector. obviously the same argument applies. Now I'll do it for the last connected component. I'm going to make a bunch of zeros. And then Laplacian n, 1, 7, and then 0. So in other words, what I've been able to show is that I identify little n distinct vectors, all of which are in the null space of L. Moreover, these little n vectors are linearly independent. Why are they linearly independent? I think it's very easy to see that they are perpendicular to each other. They're orthogonal, right? So they're linearly independent. So what this means is that I've shown that the dimension of the kernel of the Laplacian is at least n. Because I identify little n linearly independent vectors that are already in the null space. So what remains to be shown is that it is exactly n, namely that there is no other vector in the null space, right? So how do we show that that's the case? Well, any vector in the null space will need to be of this form. So if z belongs to the kernel of L, then L times z is 0. Then, of course, this means that L transpose LZ is equal to 0. But then this means that the sum, exactly that sum that I wrote over there, of the Wij's, Zi minus Zj squared, and this is sum over I being a neighbor of J, and this is sum over j belonging to sum k. Maybe I'm going to say sum over k equals 1 to n now. Right? I guess, am I forgetting out 1 half? Right? Which, 1 half. Right? So, I have a sum of non-negative quantities that must be equal to 0. So if I have a sum of squares that is equal to 0, what must happen? All of them should be 0. So, going back to this, which has the explicit terms for, so what that means is that the first one should be 0 on its own, the second one should be 0 on its own, and the last one should be 0 on its own. So what that means is that, and how is that 0? So if Wij is different from 0, right, that must imply that Zi must be equal to Cj. But because the graph, that is a connected component, once these two are equal, right, you propagate it through the whole graph. This means that the Zi must be the same over the entire connected component. Agree? So what this implies is that zi is equal to zj for all I and j in the same connected component. So, what that means is that, well, they're equal to that. Well, let me call it them, they're equal to something, but it doesn't say to what value, right? It just says that they're equal. So let me pick an arbitrary value that they're equal to. For the sake of argument, let me say that for the k component, I'm going to say that this is equal to lambda k for the k component. So what that means is that the z vector must be of the following form: lambda 1, then eventually it's lambda 2, and eventually it's going to be lambda k, right? Like all of the entries of z that correspond to the first connected component must be equal to each other. And let me call them they're equal to lambda 1. All of the entries of z that correspond to the second connected component must be equal to each other. To some value, let me call it lambda 2. And likewise for lambda k. Right? So this vector is exactly 1, 1, and then a bunch of zeros. In fact, now let me make it more precise, is 1 of dimension n1, and then a bunch of zeros, times lambda 1, plus 0 and 0 and 1 of dimension n sub n, times lambda n. Now that's exactly the vectors that I have here. Exactly these ones. So in fact, this last way of proving it is maybe the shortest one, because actually I just start with a null space and I prove that that's a null space. Okay. So in summary, that third property that says that the dimension of the kernel of the Laplacian is equal to the number of connected components of the graph tells us even more. I even computed a basis for that kernel. And that basis is the basis of constant vectors that are constant in the connected component. Okay. Now, why is this relevant and why is this useful? In manifold learning, we were interested in a situation where I had a bunch of points, right? And we were trying to build these maps to do the projection. What both algorithms really are doing is that they are connecting points to the k-nearest neighbors here. And so eventually they are building a graph. If that graph happens to be fully connected, and therefore there is a single connected component, then we're going to be in the situation that there will be only one vector in the null space, and that vector will be the vector of all ones. So that's sort of the property here about the vector of all ones being in the null space. But if the data is not well sampled, or if the size of the neighborhood that I picked is not large enough, and I am unlucky, and the data now gets to be split into two different connected components, then I'm going to be in trouble. Because there will be more than one vector in the null space. Okay? In fact, where I didn't write that, so maybe let me write here then. If graph is connected, then there is one vector in the kernel. And so, when I'm trying to solve this problem here, so the problem was minimize, for example, if I try to minimize the trace of YL Y transpose such that Y1 is 0 and Y transpose is 1. Then we set the y's, the rows of y, remember, the rows of y are equal to the second 2b plus first eigenvectors of L. Okay. That was something that we proved in the previous class, but I'm happy to prove it again so that you remember why. But what I'm trying to get at is that we have to be really careful before we apply this result, because if the Laplacian has only one connected component, then this is what we should do. But if the Laplacian has two connected components, then we should really begin a third eigenvector. Okay, let me prove this result, or reprove it. Actually, let me do it in the simplest possible case, which is the one we were just analyzing, right? So this matrix Y here is a matrix whose dimension is D by N, okay? So let me just prove this, what I just said here. Suppose that I only had a scalar and I'm trying to minimize Z transpose LZ. Then I would like Z transpose 1 to be 0. Okay, if I reduce this to the case of finding one principal component, so if I let little d to be 1, the problem reduces to this problem. Okay. And the other constraint would be that the norm of Z is equal to 1. Because all I'm saying is that in this particular case, the matrix Y is just a vector Z here, Z transpose. Okay. That's a special case. So what is this? Forget about this constraint for the time being. This is minimize the quadratic subject to the normal vector is equal to 1. What problem is that? First lecture, first homework. Given a matrix that is symmetric and possibly definite, what is, if I was maximizing Z transpose LZ subject to Z, norm of Z is equal to 1. What was that? How did we derive PCA from the eigenvectors and eigenvalues of the covariance matrix? So I repeat the question. Maximizing Z transpose LZ subject to the norm of Z being equal to 1. What is the solution to that problem? No?
Maximizing the top eigenvalue?
Yeah, the top eigenvalue. Yeah. Well, what I'm trying to find out is Z.
No, for that Z transpose 1 equals 0 constraint, I don't know.
I said, let's forget about that constraint for the time. Okay, so if I'm maximizing without that constraint and only with that, then I get the top eigenvector. Now, if I'm minimizing subject to that constraint only, what do I get? The bottom eigenvector. What is the bottom eigenvector of this matrix L? the vector of all ones, right? That's what I've been proving. That was property number two. Okay. So I repeat, without this constraint, minimizing the quadratic subject to a unit norm constraint gives me the bottom eigenvector. Okay? But the bottom eigenvector is the vector of all ones. Right? So now, what is the solution of minimize this quadratic subject to unit norm constraint, subject to the extra constraint of being orthogonal to the bottom eigenvector? Huh?
Second from the bottom.
You guys have forgotten about PCA. Let's go over the name of PCA. Find the direction that maximizes the variance. That is the largest eigenvector. The second principal component is find the direction that maximizes the variance that is orthogonal to the previous one. That gives you the second largest eigenvector, which is orthogonal to the first largest eigenvector. That property of continuing to be orthogonal, whether it's the top or whether it's the bottom, is always the same because the first theorem we saw in class is that symmetric matrices have orthogonal eigenvectors. So whether it's the smallest or... So, the same idea. I'm minimizing so I get the bottom eigenvector. The bottom eigenvector is the eigenvector of all ones. Because I'm trying to search one that is orthogonal to the bottom, I'm going to get the second from the bottom. Okay? So, the solution to this problem, Z is the second smallest eigenvector of F. So that's where this comes from, okay? That's why if I extend this now to okay, so is that clear now? Because if you think about it, if you start thinking about this optimization problem right now, right? Now, let's say we search for the rows of y one at a time. The trace decomposes over the rows of y. So it's going to be exactly, okay, so if I write y L and y transpose, and if I let y now be z1, zb, then this trace is going to be exactly equal to the sum of zi transpose L or zk, is what they use. Zi. Okay? So now, if I'm doing this problem in matrix form that I'm simultaneously trying to find all the principal components, it's the same thing as minimizing the sum of these quadratics, because this is equal to that row by row. I already showed you how to find the first one, right? How do I find z1? We conclude it's the second smallest eigenvector. How am I going to find z2 now? Well, again, it needs to be an eigenvector of L. It needs to be perpendicular to the first, to the bottom eigenvector. But because of these equations here, you know, all the rows of y need to be orthogonal to each other. So what is the eigenvector of L that is the smallest possible and that is orthogonal to the vector of ones and is orthogonal to the second smallest? That'll be the third smallest. And so on and so forth. So that's how the rows of y, or the optimal solution to that problem, is exactly going to be equal to the second, third, fourth, to the d plus first
eigenvector map. But what I was trying to say is that that works if the second eigenvector is not the if I'm in this situation now that I've got two connected components, then I'm going to have two eigenvectors associated to that zero eigenvalue. It's going to be this guy and it's going to be that guy. So in that case, I'm a little bit in trouble. In fact, you should look at this picture, which is. In a sense, the issue is really the following. If the graph becomes disconnected, I completely separate the data in two groups and do a separate manifold embedding for each one of the two groups separate. Okay. So the best thing to do in that case would be really, it's best to do clustering first. Take the data, I get the Laplacian, I figure out from the Laplacian that there are two vectors in the null space. If I can use that to separate it into two groups, now I have the Laplacian for group one, the Laplacian for group two, and now I do a manifold embedding in a per-group basis. Otherwise, we'll be in trouble. But that precisely brings us to the next topic of the class, which is, well, maybe we can then use this Laplacian eigenmaps method to do clustering. Because in fact, what I've just realized is that I can potentially take the Laplacian, and in fact, by looking at the null space of the Laplacian, maybe I can figure out the groups. How could we potentially do that? So that's exactly what I'm going to do now. Okay, so if I could use the Laplacian of the graph for clustering the data into the connected components, what would I go ahead and do? I would just start with the weights, look for the Laplacian, compute the null space, and the null space the null space is actually an indicator vector where the entries that are equal to 1 correspond to one group, and the entries that are 0 correspond to the other groups. So in fact, I'm done. Does anyone object to that clustering algorithm? I compute the Laplacian matrix. I compute the eigenvectors associated to the 0 eigenvalue. And then that using the indicators right away. And based on that, I cluster. Does that work?
Determining W ideas based on the definition of our neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm.
So how we define them as zero, then wouldn't that influence how many connected components, wouldn't that be influenced by how we define neighborhoods?
Okay, yes, sure. So maybe let me draw a picture. So suppose in fact, for the sake of simplicity, that's the data, and I'm going to exaggerate here to make the case very easy. Okay? And this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to say connect every point to its two nearest neighbors. Okay? So maybe like that, maybe it's going to be like that, maybe it's going to be like that, maybe this one will be like that. Maybe this one like that. I don't know. And, okay, I just want to do it quickly. I don't know if this is quite like that. Doesn't matter. Okay, that was first step of the algorithm. Connect yourself to your two nearest neighbors and compute the weights. Done. Now I go ahead and compute the Laplacian. Right, I'm going to get something. Laplacian 1, Laplacian 2, 0, 0. So sure, depends on the, sure, if I were to make now
to the number of mirrors equal to 100, now everybody would be connected with everybody, and there would be only one. But let's say that we're in a situation where the data clearly separates, and I choose a number of mirrors equal that is small enough, and that all of the points in one group end up being connected, and all of the points in the other group end up being connected, and I got my Laplacian. And all I'm asking is, can I cluster the data? And all I'm asking is, that's the algorithm that I propose is compute the eigenvectors, and then based on the eigenvectors, decide which, that gives you the indicators that correspond to the different clusters. And I'm asking, can I do that? Or is there an error in my reasoning?
So will there be like overlapping between the clusters?
Why?
Because the one vectors,
yes.
Like there can be ones in the same location for different one vectors.
Why would that happen?
Like, for example, in the first two one vectors, there can be like there can be one at the same location. And then that means like that point belongs to two clusters.
Well, the indicator vectors, as defined, they are disjoint, right?
Yeah. Okay.
You only have a one. In other words, if I were to put this into a matrix, that is n by n, okay, where this is the number of points, this is the number of groups. You have an entry here, that means that the jth point belongs to the ith group. But only one of them is non-zero. Because this block corresponds to this block. If I compute the kernel well, what do I get?
I think there's no guarantee you would get this basis back, so I'm not sure. Maybe there's something we need to think about in between computing the basis for the null space and figuring out these.
Numbers. So the zero eigenvalue would be repeated, right? And when it's repeated, any linear combination of these guys is also in the null space, right? Right? So in fact, the vector of all ones is exactly the sum of all the indicator vectors. And the vector of all ones is always in the null space. In fact, the sum of two of them, any combination of them, would also be in the null space. And as you just said, and all I can do by computing the null space is that I'll get a basis for the null space. But I don't know what basis I'm going to get. Any, I could get a variety of linear combinations. A priori, I don't know what's going to happen. Okay. So in fact, this is more or less what will happen. But let's say that I go ahead then, okay, let's agree on that, right? I'm going to compute a basis for the null space, so, right? And this is an n by n matrix, and this is n by little n. But look at what should happen there. Give me one second. Okay, everyone here.
Okay, but in any case, any vector in a null space needs to be a linear combination of those, right? So the form of these vectors, the form of that matrix B, will nonetheless be of the following form. Everything that is in do you agree that all of the first group would get a
what's the word I'm looking for?
What I'm trying to demonstrate is that I think this row will be equal to that row, will be equal to that row, that all of the rows corresponding to the same group will be identically equal to each other. How do I prove that? That's exactly what I put at the top. Remember what I did before. If a vector is in the null space, right, that energy function, which is the sum of the zi minus the j squared, is equal to zero. Right? Because it's equal to zero, each connected component on its own must be equal to zero. And the zi's and the zj's must be equal to each other within each connected component. Different connected components could have different values, but all of them need to be equal to. In the vector case, and the energy function for the vector case is written here, right? This is the same idea. So here's the thing in the vector case, right? In the vector case, this entire sum, again, as before, will be decomposed into the first connected component, the second connected component, the third connected component. Within a connected component, what does it need to happen? This guy needs to be equal to that guy. Right? And this guy is of dimension D. That's exactly one of the rows of that matrix. Okay? So, what's going to happen is that this is going to be a certain row, but that row is going to be repeated. So, what values could I give? Maybe I'm going to say that this is Z1 transpose here, C1 transpose, C1 transpose, this is gonna be C2 transpose, C2 transpose, and this is gonna be Zn transpose. Okay? So, the bottom line is that I'm gonna get some arbitrary basis for the null space. That arbitrary basis will not consist exactly of these indicator vectors that give me the clustering. But whatever basis I obtained, it will have the property that all of the rows are gonna be equal to each other, divided exactly. And the proof of that is exactly, I did the one-dimensional case in here. But whether it's one-dimensional or 14. In a sense, this entry here will be lambda 1, lambda 1, lambda 1, lambda 1, lambda 1. This will be lambda 2, lambda 2, lambda 2, lambda 2, and so on and so forth. And that is for one of the z's. The second column would have a different lambda for the second z, and so on and so forth. Is that clear? Okay. So pictorially, what this method is really doing is the following. Suppose for argument that I only have two coordinates. Okay? So in this particular case, I'm going to do the case of these. So what this is doing is that each row of this matrix corresponds to a different data point. And this is going to map data point, everything to two data points at the end of the day. So this is Z1, this is Z2. Right? All data points effectively get mapped to two data points, which are exactly, or in the case of two groups, they get mapped to two data points, which are going to be exactly the rows of the B matrix. Okay, now, for 1 second, forget about the math and the explanation and think about the following magical thing. The ideal model for learning really is that I had a bunch of data that was complex and I do a nonlinear transformation. Okay? Look at what happened. What this is telling you is the following. Start with any data. Build nearest neighbor's graph. Compute the Laplacian. Get the eigenvectors corresponding to the smallest eigenvalue. What happened? All of these points in group number one are mapped to Z1. All of the points in group two are mapped to Z2. So it's like really it merges all of them into one and all of these into one. So it's a nonlinear embedding that is able to map very complex structures into one vector per. And all what matters, and this is going to work perfectly, provided that you do have a graph that has, in this particular case, two connected components. And what that means is that there will be no connection from group one to group two. Okay. So this is sort of starting to give a very interesting perspective, and I hope you appreciate it. The Laplacian of the graph, if the graph is fully connected, if I consider eigenvectors 2, 3, 4, 5, d, those are the eigenvectors that give me the embedding. Those are the eigenvectors that are able to take the nonlinear manifold and produce a flat embedding. But if I consider the smallest eigenvectors, and if there are multiple connected components, if I consider the first, the second, the third, they give me the class structure. So in fact, I can start to look at the eigenvectors and divide them in two parts. What I would personally call the clustering eigenvectors, and those are the n bottom ones. And the n bottom ones, n is the number of groups. And the ones that immediately follow, so which is the n plus first, n plus second, n plus d, which are the ones that do the embedding. And so if I only look at the bottom one, they do a very bad embedding from the perspective of embedding because they map groups of points to a constant. So they completely eliminate the geometry, right? But they're so good for clustering because they tell you, oh, this is one group. Okay. So let me write it down. So in summary,
classroom. And the map, by starting with x, which is d by n. And I map it to y, which is little n by n. Okay? Where this is exactly the bottom and I invented. Okay? That's the mapping that Laplacian eigenmaps produces. So in that particular case, this Y map, as we just discussed over there, has the property that it splits Y into a matrix-based constant. It divides Y into n groups. Where all of the columns are equal to each other. So it produces a piecewise constant matrix. Okay, so in this particular case, Laplacian eigenmaps, in this case, maps n data points to little n vectors in R that give the cluster. Now, eigenvectors n plus 1, n plus 2, and n plus b give them a. So, I think now we have the corrections to make the algorithm work properly. We start with the data, find k nearest neighbors, build the weight matrix, compute the Laplacian, identify the number, the dimension of the null space, little n. And now, if I want to cluster, I look at the bottom n eigenvectors. If I want to do embedding, I look at the n plus first to the n plus b. But I need to determine that n first. And that n is just the dimension of the matrix. Right? So, next class, what we're going to see is what if I have one cluster there, but the reality is exactly one of you asked the question, right? Well, I think it was you who said, depends on the size of the neighborhood, or I could make mistakes, or in reality, I'm going to have maybe one connection like that, or a few wrong connections. So, how do we fix that? And so what we're going to see is the following. In the ideal case that we just discussed, okay, where really I have two connected components, which just show that the data is perfectly mapped to two separate points. We are going to use perturbation theory. The Laplacian is going to be a perturbed version of the ideal Laplacian we just discussed, to demonstrate that in a situation like this picture, we are going to have, instead of one point, corresponding to group one, we're going to have a collection of points nearby. And instead of the second point, we're going to have a collection of points nearby. And now, to do clustering, we can just run a clustering algorithm on this thing. And so we're going to discuss a clustering algorithm called k-means that does that. But effectively, Laplacian eigenmaps, which is what we've been talking about, plus k-means on the eigenvectors, is going to produce a very well-known algorithm called spectral clustering, which will allow us to deal with these situations and effectively sort of cut in the weak links. Okay? See you on Monday.
Okay.